Здравствуйте.
Good afternoon, dear friends. We're happy to welcome you at our session, Intercultural Dialogue as Factor in Urban Development. I'm Dmitry Politaev, Director of the Center of Migration Research. I would like to thank all those present for the interest. I must thank our speakers. Some of them have come from afar and share their experience with you. We have a few speakers today and a few participants of the discussion whom I would like to introduce. Yuri Vladimirovich Artsyukh was supposed to speak today, head of the Department of Interregional Cooperation. However, he is chairman of another session currently, and his report will be made by Anastasia Gorshkova from the same department. Also, Scott McGuire, head of the Research Center of Social Sciences, Olga Ivanovna, Australia, Olga Ivanovna Vendina, Kodzi Asaki, Institute of Urban Strategies, Vyacheslav Pastavin, President of Migration 22 Century Fund, Ekaterina Dementseva, a leading scientific researcher of the Laboratory of Research Scientists, and Dmitry Sparin, journalist, ethnologist from Moscow State University, and Gavhar Juraeva, head of Integration Center, Migration and Law. I won't take up too much of your time, just a few words. Moscow, that consists of people who came here one day, the problem of a conflict of cultures or interaction of cultures. It depends on us what we choose, interaction or conflict. And this problem should be solved both by urban authorities and us. And I think it's very important that our city is a city of migrants, those who have brought their cultures with them. And based on how we perceive this as a wealth or potential conflict depends on whether we are friends here or not, on whether our society is dissociated or it uses these different cultures as an opportunity to become richer, become an system that will be favorable for everyone. So the first speaker is Anastasia Gorshkova, who will discuss the program that helps to avoid ethnic conflicts. You can speak from your seat. Just the way you like. Dear experts, dear participants of the session, unfortunately, the name of the report was prepared by the department. I'm not going to read it now, since I head the information department. I will do it as information briefing, what current Moscow is doing, dialogue of cultures as a factor of urban development. It doesn't work. Something is wrong. Okay, an absolute priority in the sphere of international relations is the creation of a comfortable environment. Most of Russian, of Moscow population are Russians. Also, more 165 nationalities live here. The most talented people have always tried to get to Moscow. Moscow had not only a lot of churches, but synagogues and mosques as well. In addition to Russian names of cities, there were many streets named after Armenian or Oriental traditions. The dynamics of urbanizations incorporates both modern trends and careful attitude to history. Modern Moscow builds traditional churches and huge skyscrapers. Moscow takes care of historical monuments of different confessions. These are the beautiful places we have. People are the basis for everything. And the unique nature of national policy in Moscow is relying on civic society. The city has the board on nationalities. It incorporates over 100 leaders. And they interact with relevant public organizations. Also, there are over 100 national communities, and all of them are unique in their nature. All of them have a program of events in their ethnic sphere and also participate in urban projects.
Let me give you several examples. For instance, it's the festival called Russian Field, which annually gathers about over 100,000 participants, and it was 100,015. It was delivered in Moscow this year, and it was a real festival of different cultures, different national clothes, dances, and so on. And it is normally organized by national communities and the civil institutions, civil society organizations necessarily participate in that event. This is another festival of Ossetian culture. This is a feast of Georgian culture, which is called the Days of Tbilisi in Moscow. It's really valuable because the participants are not some actors that wearing national clothes, but ethnic Georgians and other people are the real participants of these feasts. And I think these events play a very important role because they create favorable and friendly environment for the dialogue and the interaction between different nations and peoples. Moscow is a unique platform for events like that. Another type of event is sports competitions. It could be football matches or competitions in other sports, with over 150 national teams participating. It doesn't mean that, for instance, Georgians play against Ossetians or some other nation. There are mixed teams, and many people also participate as spectators. The total involvement is at least 1 million participants in each big city event, including the representatives of civil society groups, organizations, national communities, and just any Moscovites. Another important component of this work is information campaigns. We'll understand that this friendly atmosphere is in particular due to media. We have created a website which is called moynarod.rf, which means our people dot Russia, Russian Federation. And this is a big website for the interaction, for the dialogue between different organizations and nations. This is a consolidated internet environment with a very friendly spiritual atmosphere. And for it is its structure resembles a house with many apartments. And each apartment is the house of some nation with its own culture environment. So you can visit other apartments, visit other nations, and familiarize yourself with the events that are going on. I think a big city should be a cradle of national, international harmony. This is done through many media culture projects, and there are several publications and several editions, like magazines and papers, on the diversity culture of Moscow and the life of different nations and ethnic communities residing in Moscow. In total, it's about 40 editions, as I said, and in particular, it's done in collaboration with the representatives of religious organizations. These newspapers, these editions, in a great demand. Moscovites perceive them with big interest, and they are disseminated 2 times a day. Plus, they are placed in internet, and some people prefer to read online. And people come to know the culture of other nations. Moscow is constantly monitoring the tension between different nations, including the work in internet. We also try to provide support to high-tech international projects. We involve the journalist students, the students of Moscow State University, and we try to use their potential, to use the potential of all sensible and constructive forces in order to mitigate international conflicts and tension. I think the youth segment of internet may be very helpful in this work. We have created a big platform for international policy. It's called Our Unity is in Differences. It is one of the biggest experts supporting us is Mr. Postavnin and his whole organization. Also, it's the NGO entitled The 21st Century, EU experts and different councils on the national affairs also provide support to our work and somehow participate in events. And still, the core participants are practical managers. And we invite them every year. And before this forum, we have discussions in all Moscow districts. We try to identify Moscow typical problems. One Moscow district normally covers the population of about 1 million people. And it may be equal to a big European city. And it's just one district of Moscow. I have just consulted some experts and showed our figures to them. I think Moscow is not trying, is not searching for some compliments, is not trying to boast on its achievements. We realize that the best result for us, the best result for authorities, is just peaceful coexistence between people. And I think we need to develop some very important trends and international policy and make Moscow as a city comfortable for all its inhabitants, including newcomers and including the representatives of all nationalities. People should be confident of their life and feel some stability. I have been just given some figures. Now, the social tension in Russia has reduced from 62% down to 53% this year. This is the result of the survey. And now, only 23% of all surveyed people are concerned about international conflicts versus 43% back in 2011. But I think we need to reduce this figure even further and to make the city environment comfortable for everybody. This piece, summing it all up, the coexistence in peace in the big city should be achieved by joint efforts of the authorities and all groups of the society. When, for instance, we tried to eliminate homeless dogs in Moscow, this was discussed by all layers of population. But now, when there are big Muslim feasts, and while people may see it and they can see it on their way to work and so on, they perceive it rather normally. And this is good because this is becoming something normal for Moscow, and this is achieved by the efforts of many volunteers, of many representatives of municipalities. Because they work at these feasts, they organize the process, and I think there are some volunteers that work at different national events, and moreover, they're even recognized. You can see how they work at the website, and even you can participate in events. Thank you so much for your attention. This is all I meant to say. Thanks a lot. And now let me invite Scott McQuire. This is our guest from Australia. If you are comfortable sitting, you can speak for sitting, or you can come up here as you prefer.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the organizers for inviting me. I'm happy to stand up. A little bit jet-lagged today. Thank you. Cultural diversity is not a new issue for cities. It's the condition of the modern city, so it's been there for probably 100 years since we see big cities formed. But I think that there is a different pattern of cultural diversity in the present because we see different kinds of mobility affecting urban populations. So we see short-term migrations, We see a lot of people studying in foreign countries, so traveling to study. We see a lot of people undergoing serial migration, so they don't just go from one country to another and live there all their lives. They migrate from one country to another over a period of years. And we see unprecedented number of people who are seeking asylum from various wars and natural disasters. So there's a lot of different complex, turbulent patterns of migration. And this raises this question of how do we live in cities that are very diverse. I want to talk about this in relation to where I come from in Australia. Australia has a very complex modern history, so I want to give you a little bit of that background. The Aboriginal Australian population have lived in the country for approximately 40,000 years. It's the oldest continuous civilization that the world has known, so there's still continuous inhabitation by Indigenous people in Australia. From 1788, Australia was colonised by Great Britain, so that caused enormous disruption and dislocation to the Indigenous population, and that still persists to the present. So now Aboriginal Australians are about 3% of the entire population. Since about the beginning of Federation of Australia in 1901, Australia for a long time had what was called a White Australia policy. So migration was limited to people who were perceived as ethnically similar to British colonisers. And this lasted up until the 1960s. So this is quite a complex, divisive history that Australia's got to deal with. But when you look at Australia, this is just a photograph from the centre of Melbourne, from a city square where I live. Australia in the last 50 years has become one of the most ethnically diverse societies on the planet. I think that we were just told that Moscow has 165 different nationalities resident here. I think in Australia we have over 200 different nationalities resident. Where I live in Victoria, you can see the graph on the left for people who were born overseas. It's nearly a quarter of the population, just over one quarter of the population were born overseas, so they're first generation migrants. If you add in people whose parents, at least one of their parents were migrants, it's nearly half the population. So this is significant cultural diversity. About a quarter of the population where I live speak a language other than English at home. And I think it's also worth noting that these fractions are actually increasing over the last 5 years. And this reflects the fact that our population growth now comes from migration. It doesn't come from internal birth rate. So it's an increasing fraction of people born overseas, an increasing fraction of people who speak a language of other than English at home. Cultural differences, ethnic differences, that degree of diversity where nearly half the population have origins, either from themselves or their parents, from other countries, can produce enormous tensions. And I'm not saying that the situation in Australia is perfect or without friction, but it's very interesting. There's an annual survey done by the Scanlon Foundation, which looks at sentiment towards multiculturalism. And the survey that was done in April this year reported that 85% of the Australian population think that multiculturalism has been good for the country. So this is a very big shift that's taken place in about two generations, from the White Australia policy up till the end of the 1960s to what the country is like now. And I think that this support for multiculturalism in Australia is a little bit of a contrast to the situation in Europe, where a number of political leaders, I'm thinking of Sarkozy in France, of Cameron in the UK, of Angela Merkel in Germany, have come out since 2011 and described multiculturalism as a failed experiment. So there's a lot more pessimism being expressed towards multiculturalism in Europe. I think there's probably two main reasons why that situation is different in Australia. One is that the consensus, the political consensus around multiculturalism developed a lot earlier in Australia. So from about the mid-1970s, there was support from both the left and the right about an explicit multicultural policy. So that's for around 40 years now. I think the other reason is that multiculturalism in Australia was not so much a top-down, government-driven initiative. A lot of the impetus came from migrant groups self-organising, so it was a bottom-up push as much as it was a top-down push. And I think that this active role of different migrant groups in articulating a multicultural policy and forging relationships with each other has been an important part of that change. So this raises this question of how do you actually build relationships between different cultural groups in a city? The sociologist Richard Sennett talks about the condition of modern cities as demanding, and I'm quoting him, a difficult and demanding form of cooperation. So Sennett talks about how do you get cooperation between people who don't necessarily share the same background, don't have the same language, don't necessarily even like each other, have inequalities, economic inequalities, etc. How do you develop this kind of civic cooperation? I think one of the things that Sennett points to, which I take very strongly, is that this isn't simply an ethical question. It's not a question of thinking what's the right thing to do. He says it's actually a matter of social skill that comes from practice. So this is where the emphasis that was talked about by the previous speaker about cultural events, about everyday life, about how people engage each other in practice is enormously important. I wanted to point to two examples, I think, that are very important for how the situation in Australia has changed. One is public schooling, because this is about engaging with cultural difference from a very young age. To give you an example, my best friend, his daughter is 10 years old. She goes to a public school with maybe 200 students. There's 80 different ethnic groups going to that school. And the situation is very similar for my two sons who go to the local school. They're engaging with children from Iraq, from Greek background, from the UK, from Somali background, in the playground all the time. So cultural difference is very normalised for them. It's not a recipe, it's not to say everything's going to be perfect, but it does provide a good foundation for awareness of other cultures. They'll learn about something like Ramadan because some of their friends are fasting at school. And it does provide a capacity for dialogue and for respect. The other aspect that I really wanted to stress was the role of public space, because I think public space, and I come from a research unit in public culture, so this is keen interest to us, but public space has always been very important for negotiating cultural difference. It's where you have contingent encounters with people who you don't necessarily know personally. And I think this is where the kinds of practices can be orchestrated by city authorities, by cultural institutions, by artists and others, to actually engage different cultural groups, not necessarily in terms of expressing their own authentic cultural identity, but in terms of creating contemporary expressions of cultural identity. I think this is quite important to think about. In Australia, there's a multicultural arts policy. It's not so much about continuing traditions, that's one part of it, but it is about allowing different cultural groups to express their sense of contemporary identity in Australia. So it's contributing to a national identity that is not static, that is not fixed, but is evolving. I'll show you one example from a research project that we work.
Я дам вам один пример из исследовательского проекта, по которому мы работаем.
From a research project that we worked on a number of years ago. This involved using a large screen in the centre of Melbourne, so it's the primary city square, Federation Square, and we developed an application working with some artists and some programmers that enables anybody who enters the square to send a text message to the screen describing where they were born and where their parents were born, and then the application on the screen will draw a map of that, and it will draw it in real time. I'll just show you some shots of people using this. If this is responsive. Okay. So it's very easy for people to just send this message to the screen. Oh. It seems to have dropped back. Can we go to the next slide? And you can see it ends up evolving this map, just showing the different origins of people who happened to be in the square at that time. It's a very simple idea, it's not particularly aesthetic, but it's very interesting because it enables people who come together into a public space to have some form of expression, some form of voice in that space. It enables them to make an individual mark because it will tell you when it's mapping your particular history, It will say mapping this particular one, it will zoom in, but then it will also locate them within a network. It will show a network of connections which shows the diversity of the inhabitants of that space. And it's interesting with this kind of application, we've also run it not just in the one square, but we've linked it up to other cities, for instance to Seoul in Korea, so that people in public spaces can actually create that interactive map between them. It's just one example of the way in which you can develop policies at a city level, at the level of a cultural institution, that enable different cultural groups to gain voice within a central urban public space. And I think this is a very important part of developing a sense of belonging in that space, and therefore of allowing people, of facilitating that kind of rich engagement with cultural difference that we think is an important part of cities. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I would like to introduce Olga Vendina, one of the leading experts in migration in Russia. Пока ничего не слышно. Thank you for the opportunity to speak here. I will try to be brief and tell you within 10 minutes something I've been thinking about for 10 years. So I will be galloping, and if you have questions, I'll be able to answer them later. The dialogue of cultures. We need to understand that cultures don't have any problems in establishing a dialogue. And even if we look at the advertisements or announcements in Moscow, we will see this combination of Cyrillic and Latin. And sometimes we use hieroglyphs or foreign words as Russian words. It's people who have problems, not cultures. What is the way we understand culture? When we speak about the dialogue of culture, we understand culture as a special mode of life, a program that is set by people's behavior on an individual level and on the level of social groups. When we understand culture this way, we have this question. Is it possible for urban community to exist in the environment of cultural pluralism? Can we achieve solidarity among different groups of people who follow different programs of behavior? And what motivates these cultures for dialogue? What motivates people for cooperation? I will skip some slides. In this slide, it's important to emphasize that urban community is not equal to urban majority or born Moscovites. Moreover, we cannot speak of urban community as a single whole. We need to speak of different urban communities, which we have a lot in the city. Even speaking of urban city majorities, it is very versatile. And in addition to social, cultural differences in our city community, we need to take into account ethnic, language, life, and other differences. Besides, we need to understand that culture is not static. that each society or community is developing. On the other hand, it's conservative enough. Generation replace each other, and the community also has its own lifetime. So young generations inherit the culture of older generations. And this way, community tries to catch up with the new level, trying to overcome its old frustrations. There's a serious contradiction. How do these new generations, how do they adapt these changes? In the communities where population growth is due to birth, they have one picture. When the growth is due to migration, the picture is different. Some of the changes are very fast, and the community cannot follow them, and cultural lag appears. Here, I would like to draw your attention to the following fact. Though we all idealize cultural diversity and share a certain romanticism in the interpretation of this concept, we need to understand that it has both positive and negative sides. Speaking of positive sides, of course, the growth of diversity increases satisfaction with life, and it leads to the recognition of those groups of people who used to be marginal, which is especially important for young people. It makes you review your ideas of the common good. If for our parents, running water and central heating was a great benefit, now it's something usual to us. And the diversity gives birth to new quality and contributes to new innovations and makes the society less rigid and more adaptive to changes. What are the downsides? Diversity results in the growth of people that do not agree with mainstream because their life program is different from this community. And diversity also questions the leading role of cultural majority. It dilutes the community. And here is the important question. Can the community do something about this contradiction thanks to self-organization? Speaking of Moscow, the research conducted last year, archaeology of the peripheric archaeology based on the surveys allowed to break up the population into four categories. The first category was post-industrial minority, which was united by the idea of individualization of life and achievement of success. It is broken down into two subgroups. Some of them is focused on material values, and the other is focusing on civil responsibility and joint activities. The largest group is conformist majority, which is united by the status of Moscovite and idea of their preemptive right to the city. Then separate groups, which we call city national communities, and also temporary migrants.
own these groups, only those groups that can build mutual confidence can organize a dialogue. So actually, we can see that a small part of urban population, and I wouldn't say that this is a sad situation, is typical of Moscow. It's typical of any big city. Only a small part of the population is open for dialogue. Nevertheless, how do these people, these different groups, they live in a high, at a high level of cultural diversity? What are the strategies to adapt to these differences? Speaking of middle class, normally the strategy of quiet segregation is chosen. They choose a particular group, a particular school, a certain resident that correspond to their idea of status. When I speak other cultures, I don't mean ethnic component, but another program of living, other values. What do most people do? What is their strategy? Protection of their right to the city, the idea of how this development strategy should be built. On the other hand, it is forming of certain stereotypes about the groups that are perceived as strangers. So this is the strategy of exclusion, which allows you to identify your own people and strangers. What is the strategy of small ethnic groups and communities? Their main strategy is recognition, self-representation, constituting and constructing their ethnic nature, institutionalization through creating institutions of civic society, not only of different ethnic groups, but also national autonomies, and fundamentalization, that is looking for bigger grounds for declaring their cultural exclusiveness. Normally, religion is the leader in this process. However, there could be other fantastic associations. Also, migrants that are not recognized
as their own people by any of the groups. The main strategy of migrants is economic integration in the life of community. Search for protection. They are not protected by government institutions, and they try to create their own institutions, parallel institutions, that would allow them to make their interaction with government institutions easier. And the last strategy is shifting to the shade sphere of social life and economy, which is not regulated. In this difficult situation, it is the government authority that should act as a mediator that would allow to develop the rules of the game for this diverse society and help to organize a dialogue. The most painful issue for the politician, what is diversity? I have already named the most of the contradictions. The desired motive for urban development, or a break in its development, an obstacle that doesn't allow us to move forward. Should we support the growth of diversity or stop it? It follows
that no urban policy can be very clear and uncontradictory. It can be a combination of urban policies with their contradictions that adapt to the current situation. What tools of policies does the world have, speaking of urban diversities? Number one, ousting of the diversity, social and cultural, to the sphere of private life, stimulating the public sphere. So diversity in private life is compensated by monotony in social sphere. This is done by all countries and republican governments. This policy is used in France, partly in Australia, and we can also say that children feel members of one group if at the same time at home they feel they are representatives of a different ethnic group. Unification of private life through tough cultural prescriptions with decorative diversity in public life. This practice was typical for the Soviet Union when there were tough social standards and consumer standards that made that harmonize private life. At the same time, we had a lot of flourishing cultures, socialist or ethnic, in their form and content. The next policy is preservation of diversity in all spheres of life, segregation of a society allowing to minimize contacts. One of the outcomes was multiculturalism. You said that multiculturalism is not European, but Australian approach, and it has a different meaning as compared to Europe. So the result is either multiculturalism or creation of certain segregated areas of diversity, like Silicon Valley. The next policy is institutionalization of diversity and its pillarization. It is widely accepted in the Netherlands, and
Moscow government now is probably has probably chosen the same way. It's done historically. Historically, there are the so-called ethnic minorities, which are the pillars of culture diversity politics, and there are institutions, and they can benefit from these institutions. The next direction is assimilation. This was the policy applied in the USA in late 20th century. This was done back in the USSR too, alongside the support to culture and national diversity. Then the next type of policy is support and control. This is done too. The next direction is the work with refugees. The refugees become a separate group of population, and there are special measures that are applied to this group. There are certain niches for this for different groups, for this diversity. And finally, this may be the policy of tolerance, which supports diversity and meets all contemporary challenges that the society faces. Normally, all these approaches are used provided, one of them is prioritized. The main challenge, and here I would like to conclude, is as follows. If we follow a certain logic, and if we encourage the drivers of cultural diversity apply all the policy and follow all these rules, well, it's possible to influence the minorities, but it's extremely difficult to impose that onto the majority, because the national majority try to be the monopolist. And we need to influence them so that they agree to participate in this dialogue of culture. This question is open in Moscow, and this is still an issue for other countries too. Thank you. This was brilliant, as usual. And I would like to ask our guest from Japan, who studies the experience of Tokyo, about his views and opinion. Tokyo is also a cosmopolitan city. So how does it manage to preserve dignity and to preserve its dignified appearance without any restrictions or destructive measures? It would be very interesting to listen to your presentation. Thank you. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. I really think that everybody that is here and all the three presentations really talked about city for all, not city for the native population, but city that everyone can feel dignity and enjoy living there. And but it's very difficult to really imagine that kind of society in Japan now, today. And Tokyo, I think, has a lot to learn from the previous examples that you talked about. And Tokyo is a world city. It's a large city, and it is one of the leading global cities in the world. And it has a very strong economy, of course, and it's got a very highly efficient infrastructure. We have all these hardwares. But in terms of the software, how people can feel the love for the city, and not only for the people who are living in the city, but as Tokyo native Tokyo citizens. But it is difficult sometimes for people coming from other countries or other cities to feel very at home in Tokyo. Although it has a certain reputation for being a livable city, but I think those foreign citizens who are living in Tokyo for a long time, I think it is still a questionable thing. It is people are, I think, having a hard time really feeling home in the city. And Tokyo and Japan, the Japanese government has been using a very sort of a policy that is not so immigrant friendly. You can see that you can see in the Japanese discourse of foreigners, and the Japanese government, as far as I remember, has never used the word immigrant to describe the people living in Japan and really seeking to live as a full citizen. They have consistently used the word foreigners. So they are always foreigners, no matter how many years living in the city. So I think, we have this background of Tokyo being not so immigrant friendly. And we have a very small proportion of foreign visitors in this 30 million population. However, though, the Japan, as many of you might know, Japan is now suffering from this rapidly decreasing population. National population reached its peak in 2005, and since it has been sort of shrinking. And it's shrinking in a very rapid pace because I think almost 200,000 people, we are sort of, the population is losing 200,000 people every year. So there is a need, I think in the government, there is a strong sense of need for foreign workers to who are willing to work, to come to Japan or come to Tokyo and work and help the sectors that are really suffering from the shortage of labor. But sometimes this, the approach is that, yes, you have, you know, a certain numbers of years you can stay in Tokyo or in Japan, but after that contract, you have to go back to your country because the Japanese government, at current status, it doesn't want the foreign workers to live such a long for such a long time. And my point of view, what Tokyo needs now is a kind of a cosmopolitanization of the city. And we have to really create a really immigrant-friendly, foreign citizen-friendly city in Tokyo. And I think what we have to start with, because it's an institutional question and it's a long-term question, and it's really hard to just, you know, get at and solve this problem so quickly. But I think what we can start from is a very small spaces in the city where we can invite these people from other countries and feel at home and really enjoy living in the city. Like some sort of refugee from this fragmentation in a society. We need some sort of, you know, place where people from other countries, people visiting the city, even temporarily, to really feel at home and really connect to the city and the people living in the city. And I think that's all.
Спасибо большое.
Thanks a lot for your presentation. Let me now give the floor to Vyacheslav Postavnin. He is a very special expert who is experienced in working for the Federal Migration Authority on the one hand. On the other hand, he right now represents an NGO, the same NGO that I represent. I feel that his experience is extremely valuable, and we would be very interested to listen to his position. Who do you think mainly helps Moscow migrants to adjust to the life in the city, and what initiatives are required? What initiatives shall we support? Thanks a lot. First, I think it's a wonderful idea. I mean, the forum like that. I would like to thank you for this organization. I was very interested to listen to the representatives of Australia and Japan. Japan is a highly conservative country, but the Japanese speaker destroyed one typical Russian myth. Some people think that we could easily do without migrants as well as Japan, but still, there's always a need for migrants. The same happens in Japan. This is a highly developed industrial country, but still it badly needs migrants. This is just an introduction. I was lucky to have visited all big continents and most of the countries, even Australia. I think Moscow is one of the biggest metropolises. Recently, many satellite cities have emerged, and they generate a big growth of population annually. This imposes a huge load on Moscow because it is hardly bearable for any infrastructure. This has happened in the recent 10 years. What is the population of Moscow and how many people visit Moscow every day? We have no idea about that. There are no figures. There are no big problems with the infrastructure except for the transport and the congestion on the roads. But probably Moscow authorities talk very little about the numbers of people that have come to Moscow recently. Mr. Artyukhov and his team has been working on that. They have many joint projects with NGOs, but it is important that we should talk about it. What about the situation with international relations and the dialogue between cultures? This problem really exists in Moscow because this is indeed an inter-ethnic city. There are many ethnic businesses and directions here. Let's take the names like Mr. Usmanov, Mr. Karimov. We often use their services. Sometimes I'm amazed to see the sign like pryaniks or the cakes from Tula, which is a traditional Russian product, plus which is followed by a table saying the candies, oriental candies. And this all imposes, as I said, a very big load on Moscow. Olga has mentioned that the government should act as the mediator or a moderator in this dialogue between culture. Otherwise, we would have some subculture which opposes local culture to the culture of migrants. Therefore, Moscow government aims to prevent this hostile subculture, which in a way tries to protect the local population from the culture of migrants. And it breeds this sense of danger. I, for instance, have spoken to many students, and they are afraid of that. Probably they have feel some xenophobia, though in many cases they don't recognize it. And the government should try and eliminate that. I think Moscow government is quite successful here. Now let me answer your question about integration and adjusting to the local culture. I think there is some problem here. First and foremost, it's the lack of awareness. I think many of the newcomers and the new migrants really lack information. I know that as an official who has worked in this area for long. I think the civil society of Russia is most active in the field of migration. There are many NGOs here. This is due to the fact that in the recent year, Moscow has received about 10,000 people from other places. And so Moscovites try to help newcomers. We need to explain to migrants where they can receive medical care, or where they can be educated, what training they might have, and so on. This information may not be very accessible even to Moscovites, to say nothing of newcomers. That's why, as I said, there are many NGOs. Some of them are rather small, but they receive many visitors daily, both in person and through their website. Sometimes they receive about 1,000 internet visitors per day. The people I represent, the NGO, where we also receive visitors, and I meet many too. Sometimes they turn to us when they're desperate and they can't count on anyone else. I think the government should support this sector of NGOs, support it financially, support it morally, and we need to fully utilize our potential. We should integrate migrants into the society, but not into governmental agencies like police, the Federal Migration Services, and so on. They should become members of the society. We need to create a channel to do that. And here we have lots of work to do. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you, too. And let me give the floor to Екатерина Деменцева. She represents the High School of Economics. She has profound experience in France. She occupied a very high position. So I would ask you, first of all, about the types of migrants that should be enrolled in these adjustment programs. Thank you. But I have worked not only in France, but also in Moscow. I would like to start by saying that I can compare several cities. I can compare Moscow to other places. Moscow have some advantages because this is a former USSR city. Let's compare it to Paris. For instance, in Paris, migrants reside only in certain districts. Sometimes they're even called ghettos. Moscow have no special districts like that. It's due to Moscow's specifics and the specifics of its built areas. In the back in 2013 and 2014, we delivered a special survey exploring the life of migrants in Moscow and in their own countries. In Moscow, their life conditions are rather poor. They always rent some apartment with several people sharing one room. However, they are able to choose a district they may prefer to live in the center of Moscow or in a suburb. They may live anywhere in all types of buildings. And if we have a chance to integrate migrants into the city, so if they already live in Moscow, they're not isolated. They do not live in satellite towns or something else. This is my main idea. I have listened attentively to the presentation made by the representative of authorities, and I think these chances must be used.
However, we need to work at the grassroots level. In Europe, I go to review migrants, and in each district there are different centers like language courses, associations of helping women, helping migrants, migrants' children, and they work on the local level. In Moscow, there is no such thing, and this is necessary for each district. Actually, these programs should not be in charge of one person. Every district should do the same. We have a big advantage in Moscow. The children, migrants' children, go to the same schools as Moscow children. So children are kind of integrated in this space. I've talked to migrants' children who integrate quite well within 6 months and become part of the school community. What groups should we pay attention to, and whom should we integrate and adapt? First and foremost, groups that are subject to negative attitude of local inhabitants. We have negative attitude towards representatives of the Caucasus, Middle Asia. Now my colleagues will tell you about neighborhoods, and it's an interesting theme. Yes, we say this is a good janitor. However, we dislike Tajiks generally. If you know who lives next to us, if we are integrated into this space, it all starts with children, with relations among people. Besides, we need help from urban authorities, not on the level of the Moscow feast and on the level of the quarter. Many children like to participate in free classes for children's recreation. If a child comes once or three times, he will be one of the community, and there will be fewer problems for this child. So we need to pay attention to the experience of other countries and make sure that we have some policy on the level of quarters, districts, well, local level. There used to be a great initiative for Russian courses in libraries. One of my students, I asked her to make a survey on the Russian language courses. Unfortunately, only in one library, Russian language courses are working, whereas initially the program was supposed to cover all the libraries. It's because of funding. And people enjoyed it. Now I think we should pay a lot of attention to it. Thank you. I think I've used my time limit. Now I would like to give the floor to Ekaterina Kazhevna, a representative of Public Opinion Fund. Now we have discussed external migrants. However, migrants can be internal as well. And normally we mean internal migrants. I will ask Ekaterina to tell us about migrant trajectories of the citizens of the Russian Federation. What are the current trends? Good afternoon, colleagues. In fact, I have a different topic. In these days off, Public Opinion Fund conducted a research on the neighborhood of different nationalities in Moscow. Within 5 minutes, I will try to discuss three conclusions that we made. For a few words about the research itself. Quite often, studies devoted to international relations measure general stereotypes. Russia is a multinational country. Is it good or bad? We decided to give up this experience and conduct our study on interaction of neighborhoods, of different nationalities. Here are our three conclusions. The first conclusion is about the initial question. In principle, is it important for you what is the nationality of your neighbors? In the screen, you can see the figures. For most of Muscovites, this is not important. However, one-third says that, yes, the nationality factor is important. What's important here? Quite often, saying that nationality is important are people under 30. And age plays an important role here. Mostly these are people with higher education, with good income. What is it connected with? The obvious reason is connected with the fact that these people have not seen the Soviet times, and they don't know about it. The second idea is that this group in itself is a closed one, and representatives are not objective in choosing their social environment. And here, the national border is close to social and economic border. When a successful Muscovite dislikes Tajiks, not because they are Tajiks, but because they are poor and 15 people in one flat. And this causes irritation in him. The idea of club flats and club quarters, when only privileged people live, it also supports this idea. This is the first conclusion. The second conclusion is the second slide is about the attitude towards specific nationalities. We reviewed three nationalities, people from the Caucasus, Middle Asia, and Transcaucasian region. We managed to compare two studies. And we asked a similar question in 2012. What would you think if a family of migrants from North Caucasus came to live nearby? In the previous study, we used the word migrants. At that time, 75% of Muscovites said that their attitude would be negative. This research was conducted when talking about neighborhoods, and we excluded the word migrant. The results were quite different. When we don't pronounce the word migrant, the attitude to other nationalities that people express is much better. If we speak of some policy today, it's obvious that migrant has a negative connotation. If we say, if we are discussing the problem of interaction among cultures, this is not equal to the problem of migration. In my view, the word migrant should be removed from public discussions when we discuss international relations. And the last conclusion, you can see two graphs. These are two different questions. They were asked to people who have neighbors from North Caucasus and those who don't have such neighbors. Based on the figures, you can see that people who have an experience of neighborhood generally say that their attitude is positive. So we can make a conclusion, and I will agree with Ekaterina, that there is a gap between abstract migrant, Chechen, Dagestan, or my specific neighbor or colleague, and this gap should be overcome. Thank you. Thank you. And now you have a rare opportunity to ask questions to our best migration experts. Please raise your hands if you have questions. Then, while you are thinking, I would like to give the floor to Olga Vandenner, who would like to provide comments on the presentations. Well, I don't really know. This is just my reaction to the presentation of Vyacheslav Postovnin. I don't think there should be a simplistic attitude to this issue.
Civil society and its relations with migrants and authorities. This is part of the main strategy of migrants' behavior that is determined by parallel institutions that already exist in the country. It's important to make a difference between institutions that duplicate functions that the government does not fulfill and creation of parallel institutions, like forming parallel cultures and parallel communities, is quite dangerous for managing the situation in the city and preservation of stability. So I would think it is more rational to humanize or liberalize the activities of government structures and expansion of their authorities, not delegation of these authorities to public organizations. On the other hand, there are a lot of public institutions discussed by Katerina Dementsova that are that focus not on legislative integration but on the adaptation of migrants to the local conditions of life. The sphere of support should be strengthened, and this is the main idea of my presentation. And even if civil society institutions are regarded as positive, the impact on the life of society can be negative and a result in the loss of control over the process. The second aspect that I would like to draw your attention to is that if we give up the myth of migration in Moscow, we need to discuss the big flows directed that are coming to the city, and the city infrastructure copes with them. The central part of the city, not more than 8% of the migration flow comes. The most of migration flows are directed at the outskirts of the city, and one-third exists between among local centers of activities. And this picture, not monocentric but polycentric city, allows the city to cope with such a huge population and such huge migration flows.
Maybe you have questions now. What do you think? And now I will give the floor to Anastasia Yurovna. Now I would like to give two local comments. To add some information to my presentation. Serious representatives of national business were mentioned, and probably we should mention that in the past 2 years, the urban agenda on interaction between nationalities. National business has been participating actively. They initiate events, which is not our program. However, apricot holiday, which Moscovites enjoyed when people danced Armenian dances and nice apricots, tasty apricots were given to everyone. This shows a social responsibility for balanced development of situations. Such programs exist in the city, and we can see some synergy among national authorities, urban authorities. And I would like to thank the program directors for good organization, and you, Dmitry, for this interesting choice of experts. I will discuss it with our manager, and I hope that the materials of the conference, presentations of our experts, it has been said that there is not enough information. We would like to have your presentations and familiarize as many people as possible about them. They would be very useful. Thank you. Now, Vyacheslav Alexandrovich and then Ekaterina. In fact, I would like to have some discussion with Olga. You mentioned interesting results. We need to understand this attitude towards North Caucasians and why this negative attitude to the word migrant. I have some answers of mine. And Olga, global practice is that all humanitarian questions connected with migration are the domain of public organizations, NGOs. This practice exists in the world, and this is quite proper. What you are saying is the reflection of our migration policy.
I think some people think that they can manage migration via police forces and via police whistles and police force. But why should this be done? And how long can you do it this way? But we decided to make a survey and reviewed all aspects of the conflicts with North Caucasians. People, I think the main conflict is property. Locals think that North Caucasians have too much property, or when property is redistributed, North Caucasians get more while they are newcomers. And probably they are wrong, but there's no transparency, and you never know why it so happened. Maybe this North Caucasian is a talented man, and this is all fair. The central TV in Russia always picks up something negative about migrants, some dirty stories and things like that. While I think it's fundamentally wrong, because many of migrants work as cleaners in the streets, and many of them make our life cleaner, but not dirtier. But we know that there are always root causes of conflicts, and we need to identify them in all cases and do away with them. I think we need to establish the right type of contact in all cases. Switzerland only gives citizenship to a migrant after six neighbors have voted for that. So it's the neighbors that vote, the representatives of the society, but not the authorities, while in Russia it's the other way around. Thank you. Thank you so much for this emotional message. And you have added spirit to our discussion. It was extremely emotional. And let us conclude our session here. Thank you so much. Let me invite you all for coffee. But just to remind you that on the 18th of December, we will be celebrating the International Migrants Day. This year, this holiday was established by the UN. In Moscow, it will have a slightly unusual format. Let me just brief you on two actions. 7 Moscow Library will deliver an event which is entitled, "Hello, Mom, how are you?" It means that migrants will be able to call their relatives from these libraries for free.
Второе пройдет при поддержке МОМ пройдет.
And the second event will include several master classes on ethnic cuisine. It will be delivered in cafes in Moscow, and this very event, "Hello, Mom," is in particular supported by the state library named after Lenin in the center of Moscow. They also have many migrant workers, for instance, working for the cafe in the library. They also work inside the library itself with books, and but they used to keep a bit aside from this work. So now they are participating. Besides, the library will host a conference on migration on the 18th of December. The participants will present the results of their surveys and the results of their practical work with migrants. So in conclusion of our session, I just want to bridge a gap and to brief you on the 18th of December. Also, thank you all for coming here. You are probably concerned about the subject, and thank you for your attention.